waking up to another light. No more sorrow and no more night. You're the light, let it shine now, let it shine now. Burning bright, cause we're not ashamed. Got a world to illuminate. You're the light, let it shine now, let it shine now.
Man,
what's going on? Fancy to see you here.
Yeah, seems like I know you from somewhere.
You might.
Oh, awesome. Hey, we got a special service for you today, and Ross and I are gonna preach a sermon together, so we're gonna enjoy this morning. And hey, it's Father's Day, and I think we ought to recognize some fathers and pray over them. How about it?
Let's do it.
Come on. Everybody, every dad here, let's stand up. If you're a father, stand with us. And look at this. Come on. Give every man a hand here. Come on. Come on. Just stay standing a minute. This is our day. This is our day. You need to celebrate yourself and honor yourself, and I'm sure your families are, and your children are, and so on. But just stay standing a minute, and you know, the power of a father and the influence of a father is well known and well documented. You know, people, there's studies that tell us the value of a father in people's lives. I want to read you a couple quotes here, and you might like. George Herbert said, "One father is more than 100 schoolmasters." Susan Gale said, "A father's smile has been known to light up a child's entire day." Sigmund Freud said, "I cannot think of any need in childhood as strong as the need for a father's protection." The author, Max Lucado, said, "My father didn't do anything unusual. He only did what dads are supposed to do, be there." It's pretty good stuff, isn't it?
That's awesome, yeah.
Yeah, what an awesome thing. Father. You know, Father. That's the title. Really any sermon that's worth anything references Father. Come on. Every prayer, Jesus taught us to pray, "Our Father who is in heaven." And we get to carry that title? Whew. Come on. Folks, And that's the one Jesus, they've said it so well, that's the one Jesus wanted us to discover, was God as our Father. And we get to carry that title. It's Father's Day. That's pretty special stuff. So Dad, you're a creator, you're strong, you're an influencer, you're a protector. There's an author who has a book called Wild at Heart. You're this creative, adventuresome, wild at heart part of God that's called Father. Huh? It's amazing. I don't know about you. That does something to me. I'm like, I carry a title that we preach about every Sunday, that we pray every prayer with. Father, you're special. Look at them around you. Tell them you're special.
You're special.
Thank you. Awesome. All you fathers watching, thank you so much. All you fathers watching online, I hope you're standing up or your family's telling you how special you are. And let's say a prayer over all of them in Jesus' name. Come on, Ross, why don't you start and I'll finish up.
Father God, I just want to thank you today for every single father represented in this place and every single father watching online, God. And the gift that is fatherhood. And God, I just lift up every single father that's still raising children and still in the lives of their children, God, that you just give them the strength and the boldness to lead well, God, and be the father you created them to be. And God, I just want to thank you for them and the gift that they are in Jesus' name.
Yeah, and thank you, God, that as we pray for fathers, we pray for the spirit of fatherhood over them and every person. No doubt people are watching us and listening and are here, like myself, who grew up without a father. And I thank you that the spirit of fatherhood from God makes up that difference. You said you'd be a father to the fatherless. But we're recognizing fathers, us fathers who are here now, and let that spirit of fatherhood be even greater in our life than ever before. Thank you for what you've put in us that comes straight from you. Thank you for letting us carry a title that you wanted to reveal yourself as to us through Jesus. That's an honor. That's a privilege. We love you and we love every father, and we believe they're covered and they're blessed by your great name, your great authority, and your great favor in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Hey, point to another father around you and tell him you're blessed. You're blessed.
Hey, so it's Father's Day, and we wanted to do something special, get up here and do a special Father's Day sermon. And we were thinking, you know, what could we preach on Father's Day? Like, what would be appropriate to preach on Father's Day? And so we want to do a sermon on fatherhood. And I kind of asked my dad, I said, you know, if I asked you, what would you say it means to be a father? Like, everyone's got a father. But if you ask some people, depending on the person, some people would say they didn't really have a father in their life. So, you know, in a sense, most men are fathers, but what does a good father look like? And so that's what we kind of want to talk about today. And do you want to add anything to that?
Yeah, you know, that reminds me of when you were born. You were born on a Sunday morning, by the way, and we were getting ready. Church was happening. It was right before church, and they got to announce. Does anybody remember that Sunday morning in 1999? And they announced that we had our firstborn son at church, and we didn't have him at church. They announced at church.
That would have been interesting.
Yeah, and so we've done a lot of things at church, but one thing we haven't done is had babies at church. And Ross was born, and I, you know, he started growing up and getting curious and getting into. We got pictures of him climbing into our kitchen cupboards, our kitchen cabinets, you know, and I told you or prayed in the prayer, I grew up without a father. My father was killed in an accident when I was 8 years old, and so I grew up without a father, and so here I have a son. And when we found out that we were pregnant with our first child, I laid around on the couch for about 2 or 3 weeks. The impact of it just knocked me sideways. I just, the weight of it, you know, just realizing I'm gonna be a father. I know the rest of you guys are a lot bigger than that, but man, I literally was just like dumb for 2 weeks, and And so he starts toddler, you know, and God, I didn't have a father growing up, and but I want to be the best father I can be. So teach me how to be a father. And so I started saying something to Ross. I'd say to him, hey, when he'd do something, I'd say, that's a good boy, you know. And when I prayed that prayer, God stopped me and said, don't say that to him anymore. Don't say, according to what he does, you're a good boy. And I immediately caught it and went, yeah, right. So from that time on, I would jump in bed with the kids every evening when they were little and talk to them and tell them things. And here's what I would say to him before Juliana was born. When he was a little guy, I'd jump in there and I'd say, Ross, you're my son. I love you, and there's nothing you can do about it. And then we raised him that way. That's been my attitude and my heart toward him ever since. There's nothing he can do. He's not a good boy because he does good things. He's a good boy because he is my son. I love him, and there's nothing he can do about it.
I'm glad God told you that, because I haven't always been a good boy. It reminds me, there was this one time, actually.
Oh, no.
It was a couple years ago. I used to play golf when I was a kid. And I kind of got away from it. And my dad was telling me, hey, you know, if you're thinking about being a pastor, one thing you got to pick up is the game of golf. And so a few years ago, I started playing golf. And if you've ever played golf, you know it is the game that will make you mad. Like, really mad. And so I didn't want to go out and embarrass myself on the course. And so I was at home practicing, and we go to the driving ranges, but a college student going to driving ranges, it gets a little pricey. And so I knew we had a bucket of golf balls at the house, and I decided, hey, we got a couple acres. I'll just use my own yard as a driving range. And I started hitting them toward the main road. And we're far enough away, you know, I wasn't too worried, and they started to get closer and closer to the road, and I started to think, man, I got to back up a little bit. So I backed up where I was no longer parallel to the house. Parallel is your safe zone, and if you go behind that, bad things can happen, and I learned the hard way. I got up to swing, and I thought to myself, you know, I'm just going to hit one more. Let me just tell you, if you ever think, let me just do something one more time, don't do it. I've lost too many lures and made too many mistakes doing something one more time. And so I got up to swing, and I go to crack this golf ball, and I barely hit it. And it shoots straight out toward the house. And I'm thinking to myself, this ball is going slow motion. And I'm thinking, is this going to hit the truck or the window? It's going to hit one of the two. Is it going to be the truck? And it cracks the side of his truck, his F-150. And I just gasp. And I go up to it, and I see the dent in the side. And I'm going, you know, maybe I can fix this. So I go get a mallet out of the garage. And I'm thinking, if I could hit this dent out, maybe he won't notice it. And sure enough, he hears me hitting the dent out of the side of his truck. It never got fixed. I think the dent was still there till you sold the truck.
I just got rid of it a few weeks ago, and it still had that dent in the back fender, a big ping in the back fender. And he's out there he's up under the tire trying to mallet out that, hit out that dent, you know, and I said, son, it's not going to work. That thing is way too, you can't do it. Anyway, I never got the dent fixed. And he was, of course, scared, half silly, you know, and I said, son, it's okay. Everybody does it. And I was just thrilled he was out practicing golf, you know. I looked at the dent and never fixed it I got a lot of other things fixed on the truck. Even when I had some accidents with it, people ran into me. I'd never let them fix that dent. Here's why I didn't let them fix it or have it fixed, is because every time I walk out of a store or somewhere and walk up, the sun was shining just right. There's that big old dent. And I would just smile because it reminded me of my son. It didn't matter that he hit the truck. It just reminded me of my relationship with my son, and that it really didn't matter what he does, that he is my son, I love him, and it doesn't matter what you do. That's end of the story. I, for years, walk up to the truck, see the dent, and just smile, go, my son, he makes me laugh.
Hey, that's a good father right there. Come on. But we kind of teased the question in the beginning, you know, what is a father? And so I think it's only appropriate we turn to a little bit of scripture and we see what the Bible says about being a good father. So today we want to read you the story, everyone knows it, of the prodigal son in Luke 15. And I like what one commentator said. He said, you know, I don't think the name the prodigal son is as appropriate as if they would have said the story of the loving father. There's so much in there about the character of a loving father. And ultimately, you know, it's pointing to God the Father, as we talked about earlier. But, you know, I think we can take away so much about what it is to be a good father.
Yeah, for sure. And that's, you know, they always refer to it as a prodigal son. But really, it's the loving father. The story is about him. Let's read it, Luke 15, shall we? Luke 15, verse 11 through 24. Just follow along, or if you want to find it in your Bible, I'll give you just a moment to find that. We'll read it. Then we're going to break down this story a little bit for you today, see if we can discover what a father might be, that explanation. 15, verse 11. I'm going to just read the whole story, okay? Ready? Then he said, a certain man had two sons. The younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the portion of goods that falls to me. So he divided to them his livelihood. And not many days after, the younger son gathered all together, journeyed to a far country, and there wasted his possessions with prodigal living. But when he had spent all, there arose a severe famine in that land, and he began to be in want. Then he went and joined himself to a citizen of that country, and he sent him into his fields to feed swine. And he would gladly have filled his stomach with the pods that the swine ate, and no one gave him anything. But when he came to himself, he said, how many of my father's hired servants have bread enough and to spare, and I perish with hunger? I will arise, go to my father, and will say to him, Father, I've sinned against heaven and before you. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired servants. And he arose and came to his father. But when he was still a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion, ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. And the son said to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and in your sight, and am no longer worthy to be called your son. But the father said to his servants, bring out the best robe, put it on him, put a ring on his hand and sandals on his feet, and bring the fatted calf here and kill it. Let us eat and be merry, for this my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. And they began to be merry.
Wow, isn't that an awesome story? Story of the prodigal son. Hey, we're going to break it down, but I want to start out and just share a few things from that first section. If you're taking notes, I encourage you to write down this little title, Away from Home. Away from Home. The prodigal son, he starts out in this story, and he's so ambitious, and he goes to his father and wants these possessions, you know, wants what is his, so he can go out. And I think, you know, he wanted his possessions from the father because he wanted to go out and look for something. Something that he thought would satisfy an urge inside of him, right? But who knows that the world will never satisfy the true desires of our heart.
Yeah.
That what we truly desire is only found in God.
Come on.
And in Jesus.
Yes.
Amen?
Yeah.
And so, you know, I love it that the father actually gives his son what he, you know, owes him, what belongs to him, to go out and waste. And I think this so well shows us how God looks at us, is that, you know, God gives us the right to make our own decisions. He calls it free will. That doesn't mean that God doesn't love us. God, the father loved his son, but he gave him the decision to make his own choices, gave him the right to make his own choices. God gives us the right to make our own choices. And there's a lot of people walking around like the prodigal son. They're looking for something. God loves those people, and he wants to be in a relationship with those people, but he gives them the decision to choose for themselves. But he longs for them to choose him. You know, the prodigal son, he went out, and he wasted everything he had looking for something to satisfy. I think there's a lot of people today that they're wasting what they have looking for something to satisfy. Not just wasting resources. Yeah, that's one thing, you know, wasting money, wasting resources. But the prodigal son, he wasted time. Time he could have been with the father. Wasted time. He also wasted relationships. Of course, that relationship with his father was restored. But what if he would have never came back? That relationship would have been wasted. How many people today are wasting relationships, time, and resources? Looking for the wrong things. Looking to the world to satisfy something that will never satisfy. And God's saying, you just got to look in the right place. You just got to look to me. Amen? Amen? So as believers, I encourage you, hey, if you see someone looking for something to satisfy, tell them, hey, you're not going to find it in this world. You're going to find it in him. Yeah. Amen?
Oh, my. Yeah. Yeah, I mean, and that's the condition of mankind. That's the condition of people. We call it depravity in theological terminology. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Every person in some sense is a prodigal then that needs to come home to the Father and complete that circle of love. Mm-hmm. We've all fallen short of God's glory, and we're out there and we're trying to satisfy with other things, but Jesus came. And thank God he restored us. But this problem of man, you don't have to look far to see that people have missed the mark. They've missed the mark. And that's what the prodigal son found out. It didn't matter how hard he worked out there. It still came up to feeding pigs. It didn't matter how much he spent, how much he invested. It still was wasting his life. There still wasn't peace. There still wasn't what he wanted in his life. So he's out there. It speaks of the problem of mankind. And that's why we preach the gospel, is because we got to tell people, man has a problem, but God has an answer. Wow.
So good. Hey, man has a problem. But if you're taking notes, I want you to title this next section, But the Father.
Yeah.
But the Father.
Yeah.
The son came back to the father and was like, hey, this is what I deserve. This is what I've done. This is what I believe you should give me. But the father said differently.
Yeah.
But the father actually did differently. And I think it's here where we see what a good father really is. He's a provider. And he provided his son with three things. Check this out with me. Luke 15:22, if they'll throw it up on the screen. It says, But the father said to his servants, bring out the best robe and put it on him, and put a ring on his hand and sandals on his feet. And it's here, I think, if you really look deep in his text, you discover what a father should give to their children, and what ultimately God has given to us is a robe. What did the robe represent at that time? Son's condition. Son's condition. He came back and said, hey, make me a servant. He said, no, I'm going to put a robe on you. That represents sonship. You're my son, not based on what you did, not based on what you think you deserve, but just because you're my son, you get the robe.
Yes.
Amen?
Yeah.
It's not about who we are, good or bad. It's about whose we are.
Yeah.
And we're his. And so he says, hey, I want to put a robe on you. And it doesn't matter what you've done. You deserve this robe just because you're my son. Come on.
Come on. Yes.
It's there when we get that robe, when you provide, on a super practical note, your son with that acceptance and that kind of love, that ultimately he finds true security. There's true security in Christ in knowing that it's not about what we really do. Yeah. It's about who we are.
Yeah.
And then the ring. What does the ring represent? I think the ring represents authority. Yeah. Right? He gave him the ring, and this says, hey, wherever you go with this ring, you have my kind of authority. And hey, I'm going to save this for my dad, but on a super practical note, for the fathers, just look at your sons and saying, hey, I believe in you. Yeah. That's that kind of authority.
Yes, yes.
Like, I believe you can do something in life.
Yeah.
Like, I'm looking at you, and I see potential. And then the sandals, what are the sandals? That's purpose. That's saying, hey, go out. You have something to do. So not only do I believe in you, I give you the ring, but now I believe that you can't just do something, but you are made to do something.
Yeah.
Amen? So the father, he gave him the robe, the ring, and the sandals. To all the fathers, let's give our sons that kind of same security, love, the belief in them, and instill in them that, hey, you're made with a purpose. God's put you on this planet for a purpose. Amen?
Oh, the righteousness, the condition of God that is given to us. And there's nothing more devastating. I don't need to tell you this, but I'm going to say it anyway. There may be nothing more devastating to a person than to have had a father not believe in your condition and always make you think you're not enough. Unfortunately, that's the case sometimes. But see, that's the beauty. We get to point us all to the Heavenly Father. As you may look at us and go, wow, he's a pretty good father or dad or somebody is. You know, we are none of us perfect. This all points us to the perfect Father. It doesn't matter what we've missed or what somebody's missed. It may have devastated us to have had somebody in our life that always gave us the feeling that we were never enough. But there's a father who will never make you feel like that. And true fathers who want to be a godly father ought to try to do the same thing to their children, to tell them, you are enough. Because look, it doesn't matter. Everybody's different. Not every child, every person's the same. Not everybody can do the same. Not everybody can live up to everybody's expectations. But to a father, their child is the best there is. And to the Heavenly Father, we are all His children. He has made us the righteousness of God. He put a robe on us. And did you notice? You may not have noticed because we're not really putting the text up and going through it real, real carefully, except these three things. But the son came back and he said, before he got there, he said, I'm not worthy to be a son. I've sinned. And by the way, that every person needs to recognize, we ain't got it. Word of faith folks some time ago were so big about never call yourself a sinner. Like, just never say you're a sinner. And I'm like, say it. We are sinners, but. It'd be better for some of us to say, I'm a sinner, but Jesus saved me, than to be so proud about what we say that we may be sinners and not even know we're sinners. But my point is this. If you don't recognize how little you have to bring to the table, you may not be a candidate to be saved yet. You got to know you ain't got nothing. This prodigal son knew he had nothing to bring. And he said, I'm going to go and I'm going to tell him I'm a sinner. And I'm not worthy to be called your son. And I'm going to tell him. I'm going to tell him. Make me a hired servant. In other words, keep me at the house if I do good enough, but you can fire me anytime you want to as soon as I don't do it well enough. All I'm worthy for is to be a servant. He gets to the Father, and he's going to tell that whole thing. And he says, Father, I've sinned. I'm not worthy to be your son. And before he gets to tell him what he should do, make him a hired servant, the Father interrupts him and says, get the robe, get the robe, get the ring, get the sandals. this my son was dead and he's alive. Come on, his condition is based on how I see him, not what he did out there or what he thinks he's worthy of or whether he thinks he owes, he lives up to some standard or whatever. His condition, the robe is what comes out of my house to put on him, and I'm going to give him a ring of authority so that he can walk in the authority that I have. No weapon formed against him is going to prosper. He can cast demons out. He can do the things the house has authority to do because of what I have for him, not because of what he thinks he deserves. Come on. He made us righteous, gave us his authority. Can you believe it? That if I say, devil, leave me alone in Jesus' name, he can no more stay in my presence than he would in Jesus' presence. Don't have to go, well, I was good enough this week. I fasted. I went to church. I did all this. The devil's got to leave me alone. No, the devil's got to leave me alone because I'm in the Father's house. He gave me his ring. Hey, you see that right there? You see that ring on my hand? My Father's house. Glory be to God. And he put sandals on his feet. Good.
Man, condition and authority. But then I just want to take a second to touch on purpose. Who knows? God's made us all with our own individual purpose in life. That we're all made with a purpose and we all have a purpose. You know, there's this story that they tell each year at Camp Decision. I want to share it with you all. It's pretty powerful. It's about this boy, actually two boys that went to school together, and one was kind of popular and one wasn't so popular. And there was a day when the boy that wasn't so popular was cleaning out his locker, and the other boy comes up to him and says, hey, you know, I've seen you around. I see you don't really hang out with that many people, and I want to invite you to the game this afternoon, the basketball game. And the shy boy kind of looks at him and says, you know, I don't know. I think I got plans. And then he said, you know, actually, I'll be at the game. I'll see you at the game. And he said, okay, sounds good. I'll see you at the game. And you know, they exchanged contacts or whatever and went their separate ways. Anyway, come to find out, the boy that invited the one to the game would soon learn that the boy that he went up to talk to was actually suicidal. And it was that day he was cleaning out of his locker room and had a note that he had left inside that said, hey, you know, I've been going to this school forever and it just seems like I'm living life and no one sees me. Seems like I'm just invisible here on this planet and I don't really think I belong anymore. And it was the actions of one boy that changed this kid's whole life. Wouldn't you say that's purpose? See, sometimes we think purpose is this big thing that we got to go out and do and achieve, and we're, you know, but I think God's made us with a purpose. I think that purpose could be summed up just as people. That our purpose as Christians, as the church, is people. That the reason we get saved and we're still here is because there's people that aren't saved and are still here. And God's saying, Jesus is saying, hey, I've left you with a message. I've left you, and I want to transform you into a disciple, someone who goes out and speaks and lives the truth, shows people who I am, and tells people about me. I believe that's us as believers, right? That we have a purpose in life, and no matter where you're at in life, there's people around you who need what you have. People really need Jesus, but because Jesus is using you, people need you. Amen. So let's live life with like an excitement. Like I'm here for a reason, and anywhere I'm going, whether it's at a job I don't really love right now, or it's a job I do love, or wherever I'm at in life in the middle of COVID-19, I have a purpose, and it's to reach people and shine the light of Christ. Amen. Come on, say to yourself, I have a purpose. Amen.
Yeah. What is a father? We might have just discovered it in these three things the Father gave his Son. Huh? How would we describe a father? You know, Ross told me this when we were studying and looking at doing this sermon together. He said, I bet I could ask everybody at church what's a father, and they'd be different answers. And I have a feeling that there'd be a lot of people who would actually fumble. Like, well, I don't know. I mean, we try to, you know. I think we found it in the prodigal son story, the loving father story, that if we want to be good fathers, we let our kids know you're enough to us. Your condition is just right for me. Never giving them the feeling that they just aren't enough. You're my son and I love you and there's nothing you can do about it. You're my child. We say son a lot because of the story, but you're my child. And you're my child. And then the authority. Man, those kids are looking for their dad to see them play the game. Moms, they want you there too, but there's something about they look for, is dad here watching? Is dad seeing us run this race? Is dad seeing us? Remember the touchdown you caught for to finish the season in the corner with your feet dragging in the corner of the end zone?
How could I forget?
Yeah. Wouldn't have been the same if I hadn't have been there, right? Of course, mom was there too. But they're looking for their parents and especially their dad to see them. It's authority. It's what gives them it's you can do this. You can go. There's something on fathers to give that to their children and purpose. Man, come on. Our children, tell them. God's got you here for a purpose. You're here for more than filling time and just getting a job and making it through life. And Ross was getting ready to go to college, and because of his grades and who he is academically and in leadership, and he had all kinds of awards and things in different areas and honors roles and what have you. So he was good to go to good colleges. We went and toured colleges and we looked at some of the best and private colleges, and he had scholarships to use and all that kind of stuff. But this thing was in him. I have a purpose. And he said, you know, I just don't feel right about those colleges. He said, that prestigious place, I mean, everybody would be like, you went there? You are a graduate of there? And you know, you kind of want that for your son, you know, kind of thing. And but in his heart, and he one day he comes to us and goes, it's just not right. He said, I have peace about something else. And besides that, when God was moving at camp, God called me to the ministry. And I'm going to college here. We said, praise God. He's found his purpose. He's happier than he could ever be. Doesn't matter that the other colleges went by the wayside. He's fulfilling his purpose, doing a pretty good job of it this morning too, isn't he? Come on. Come on. And so that's what fathers, that's what you want to do, put in your children. But that's what God gives us. Whew. There's not a person on this planet without purpose. God, we thank you. We praise you. Come on, let's stand together. Let's stand together. And just once you're standing, just bow your heads for a moment and thank you, Ross. And you know the text at the end. Once the father has received his son back like that, then the end of what we read said, then they began to be merry. Come on, true joy. True joy. True happiness. The real party is at the father's house. The prodigals think it's out there with wasteful living or whatever they're doing out there. The prodigals think it's out there somewhere. Real party is in the Father's house, in the purposes of God, living in who God made us to be, in the condition of God's children that God created us to be. There's where the party is. Come on. They began to be merry. We didn't even get to the older son who was a religious old geezer in the back fields. Sorry. He was. He was a religious old guy back there, and he comes in. He couldn't understand the party because he thought you had to earn a party. And didn't realize we party because we're in the Father's house. Come on. That's where real joy is. Close your eyes and bow your heads, would you? Worship team, if you'd come. And just with heads bowed and eyes closed here or wherever you're watching, this is a good time to say I trust God with my life and my eternity. You'll get saved. You'll be born again. You'll have new life in Christ. You'll be given this gift. This gift. Oh God. I give Ross and I and our family and this church a megaphone to preach the gospel around the world. We got to tell more people what God has done. What a God, what a Father He is. So right now is a good time to receive the fatherhood of God. How do I do that? I trust you. Well, let's just back up a little. Tell Him you don't have anything to offer. Because as long as you got something to offer, he can't really give you what He's got. So a good thing to say is, I'm a sinner. I don't deserve any of this, but the Father. I trust Him. In Jesus' name. If you do that here or anywhere that you're watching, would you just slip your hand up, say, yeah, that's me. I'm that's me. The Spirit of God has led me to the Father's house. Call on His name and I'm saved. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Come on. I just want to pray this final little prayer. That the Spirit of adoption, that means placement as a son, would come on every person on this Father's Day. And it would heal every wound, every ache, every father ache for the people that are under the sound of my voice. Like it did for me, like it does for me. The Spirit of the Father. And I receive that. And pray that spirit of sonship over every person. We're heirs of God and co-heirs with Jesus Christ. That means I'm humble enough to say, I don't have anything to offer, but I'll walk into His house with His condition on me, with His authority, and with purpose for my life. I'll walk into His house and accept. Accept this gift from the Father. I give you praise. He loves me. I love Him. He loves me and I love Him. Come on, would you lift your hands up? We got to worship God. You got to thank somebody like that. Jesus' name. Every pain, every hurt's gone in Jesus' name. Bodies are healed. There's even pain leaving people's bodies right now in Jesus' name. The back just stopped hurting right there. Healing is flowing. It's the Father's house. He has all your provision. He has all that you need. Spirit, soul, and body. Hallelujah. People who can't sleep. Tonight you're going to sleep in the peace of God. We give you praise, God. The Father's love. Woo! Come on, there's a merry heart. There's a party at the Father's house. Come on. Lift those hands up and let's begin to rejoice. God, we thank you for the. We thank you for what you've done and what you've invited us to. This is where we really start being merry. This is where true happiness is. This is where the dance is. This is where the joy is. This is where life is. This is life, and this is life more abundantly. This is God's life. Woo!